It's an extreme spearfishing experience, pushing conservation to the cutting edge when man and beast collide in one of the planet's ultimate adventures. Chasing Marlin. Some of the most extreme encounters of man and ocean beast aren't for sport. They're for science. And for over a century, some of the closest encounters of all have involved tagging. From simple serial numbered tags to the most advanced sonar and satellite technology, implanted tracking devices allow science to follow fish and go where no human could survive. And now, one audacious team is taking on an intense new challenge. Spear tagging. Intrepid biologists, Dr. Tim Sipple and Gillian Morris, are embarking on an expedition to remote shark-infested waters. They're enlisting the help of two of the world's best spear fishermen, Steve Hathaway and Dean Martin. Together, they're determined to tackle one of the ocean's most incredible and threatened beasts face to face. The striped marlin.
There's just so many things that add into it that makes it so hard. To be able to pull it off, you pull this off, it'd be unbelievable.
February the 11th, 2010. Snell's Beach, New Zealand's North Island. The international expedition has gathered on this stretch of Pacific coastline to put their tagging mission to the test.
New Zealand's a fantastic place to be if you're a human or a marlin, and especially if you're a human that wants to catch a marlin.
Noted fisheries biologist Dr. Tim Sipple has lived in New Zealand for years, tracking striped marlin migration patterns and behavior.
We have two pop-off satellite tags here.
As marlin become increasingly threatened, much of Tim's work involves implanting sophisticated satellite tags.
36 satellite tags have been put into striped marlin since 2003. It took a long time to get that, so it doesn't sound like a lot, but it actually is.
Yet for Tim, this mission is unlike any other.
And I think if we have two or three of us in the water, just to keep a close eye on the shaft.
He wants to implant state-of-the-art satellite tags using a daring and revolutionary method.
Oh, baby!
Traditional satellite tagging involves hooking and reeling in fish to a boat, implanting tags, and then releasing the fish as quickly as possible. The tags collect data on fish location and transmit it via satellite. But is tagging data 100% accurate? To the captured animal, tagging is highly stressful. For Tim and pelagic species researcher Gillian Morris, one question is critical. Does the stress of rod and reel tagging actually change a fish's behavior?
Tim really wants to see how the animal is going to behave when it's not brought into the boat. That's the biggest thing, because he's found that marlin behave differently after they've caught on rod and reel and a tag is placed.
The satellite tags are showing us that they're leaving these peak feeding grounds at an optimum time, and the only reason that so far we can explain that with is that there's a response to the capture process.
If the stress of capture does change marlin behavior, it must be factored in.
It doesn't suggest that anything needs to be done differently, but what it does suggest is that we need to understand this process more closely, and we need to be able to incorporate this into scientific management practices.
One way to understand rod and reel tagging data is to compare it to data captured in an entirely different way, spear tagging.
The intent is to lure the fish up to the back of the boat, and when the fish is nearby the boat, a spear fisher could get in the water and put one of these tags in with his spear gun.
It's an extraordinary challenge. Marlin spear tagging has been done before. Anglers have successfully implanted tags using spear guns. But no expedition has landed a satellite tag that stayed in long enough to gather valuable data.
It looks like it's going to be good vis in there.
On this trip, two daring spear fishermen are determined. For decades, Steve Hathaway and Dean Martin have been spearfishing big game for food and sport, shattering world records, landing monster fish.
The thing I love about this is that I've killed some of these bigger animals and I don't have any desire to do that anymore. And to be able to jump in the water and to learn more about these animals that we love so much is just hugely exciting.
Every time you go in the water, you just don't know what's going to be around the corner. You just want to explore and check it out. It's just, it's always exciting. Just an amazing sport.
Though experienced, Steve and Dean have never used their spear guns to implant sophisticated electronic tags. For the mission, Tim has chosen the MK10 PAT satellite tag. Once deployed, this nearly 30-centimeter-long tracking device collects information on temperature, depth, and sunlight intensity, identifying where a fish is swimming in the water column. After a month, the tag detaches and transmits its data via satellite.
So this tag is $4,500, and we get one shot at a marlin to get these data. So this is kind of a gamble. It's kind of all or nothing.
But any spear tagging is extremely risky. A spear fisherman must hold his breath for up to 4 full minutes, free diving in unpredictable currents, often far out at sea. Steve and Dean will have just seconds to make a shot. For the best chance of the tag lodging and staying put, the spear fisherman must hit a tiny target, aiming for the thickest skin just below the marlin's dorsal fin.
You're talking about an area about that big on an entire large animal, and it's also a moving target.
To increase their chances, Dean has handcrafted the ultimate underwater tagging arsenal.
We really do need to consider loading up with a little bit more power. Made this in the old garage. While it's very heavy out of the water, once we're in the water, it's actually very manoeuvrable.
Custom-made from native New Zealand timber, Dean's gun is loaded with a 2-meter-long metal spear, resting in a groove along the main shaft. When fired, thick spring-loaded rubber tubing propels the spear through the water with an incredible force. Upon impact, the tag attaches itself to the fish, and the spear falls away. But with the satellite tag weighing down the end of the spear, the accuracy of the gun is uncertain.
And it's a bit of a concern for me, to be honest. You know, how the spear's going to react, how quickly it'll fall away and lose momentum.
Their ultimate goal? To land a tag in a striped marlin. But the expedition isn't ready yet. Steve and Dean hope to fire a practice shot at a slower-moving, more accessible but dangerous target. A bronze whaler shark. Common in New Zealand waters, bronze whaler sharks are stealthy and strong. These monsters can reach over 3 meters long, weighing more than 270 kilograms. Yet among spear fishermen, bronze whalers are notorious competitors. Wily opponents who shadow free divers, charge in, bump them, and snatch a catch right out of an angler's hands. Left to themselves, sharks never deliberately target humans. But when divers invade their habitat, any encounter can be risky.
I'm assuming we'll go in and they'll be swimming gracefully around us. They can be intimidating as well sometimes, but that'll be fine, man.
I'll get this on for you.
Steve and Dean plant a free dive, move in close, sneak up behind a large bronze whaler, and shoot a dummy practice tag onto the shark's back. For biologists Tim and Gillian, it's the moment of truth. Is their spear tagging mission up to the challenge?
There's a fin on the surface, right at 12 o'clock.
For expert spear fishermen Dean Martin and Steve Hathaway, it's the ultimate test run.
Yeah, there's quite a nice current.
For Dr. Tim Sipple, it's a critical mission.
Keen to hear how it goes.
To make tagging breakthroughs with deep sea marlin, the expedition needs this practice run to succeed. Targeting a powerful bronze whaler shark with a spear tagging gun. Steve patrols the area, spearing bait fish to help attract a shark.
We've actually speared a lot of fish. If we chum up the amount we've got here, mate, we'll just have them all around us.
Slide that in. So this is gonna slowly release a scent trail as it starts to thaw in the water. I'm just gonna clip it off the side of the boat here, and then I'm gonna dump some concentrated fish oil in. That way it just creates a real strong slick. So if there are any sharks, even remotely close, we should get them interested to come around.
Diving in an alpha predator's chum trail is extremely dangerous. Though Steve and Dean welcome the chance to swim with sharks, they can't let their guard down. When threatened, a bronze whaler will strike.
Yeah, they're definitely all, look, they're all swimming together and they're all watching something.
Yeah.
That's probably 2.5 meters long.
Good news. Got a shark hanging around out there.
A large bronze whaler has smelled the free meal, and it's coming in for a closer look.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Got some action out there.
Dean carefully follows the shark darting beneath him. Bronze whalers are intimidating. Broad, blunt snouts sport rows of hook-shaped teeth. Dean must appear calm to avoid agitating the hunting shark and be ready to fire. It's a direct hit. The dummy tag lands just below the shark's dorsal fin.
Yeah!
What's the point tag?
Right!
That's
awesome!
The team now knows the range of their spear gun. But will the tag stay embedded in the fish without harming or visibly changing the animal's behavior?
That's beautiful. Well done.
Perfect. The fish has actually turned around now and it's playing back in there. So in terms of like the impact on the fish, it's hanging. It's not upset. Nothing's bothering it.
That's really good news. This sort of is our first indication that the method can be useful for answering the question that we're after. Well done, mate. Excellent.
Can tagging data be captured without changing a fish's behavior? The team's first test run shows promise. The harmless dummy tag will detach in a few weeks.
He didn't show any aggression towards you at all, being the one that put it in there.
No, loves me, loves me.
Encouraged by the whaler shark's response, Dr. Tim Sipple heads back to shore. He's eager to resume his work in Auckland, where he'll study results of the team's Marlin mission. For the other expedition team members, the real trial has just begun. Can they pull off the same feat kilometers out to sea against a massive leaping marlin? Next stop, Three Kings Islands, and an extreme close encounter, a quest for a scientific breakthrough, spear tagging one of the fastest fighting fish in the ocean. But whether it's marlin, sharks, or any other alpha predator, seasoned veterans know tagging risks are severe.
It's gonna be a good day out here.
On the other side of the world, one experienced angler discovers that catching and tagging can turn dangerous. July 2002, Boston, Massachusetts.
That clips you in. Take these clips. Here, those are the harness clips.
So I'm going to be attached to the pole?
You'll be attached to the pole, correct.
Sport fisherman Jimmy D'Ambra and his uncle Casey Carnevale head out with friends for their favorite pastime. Shark fishing.
Shark fishing is fun because it's like hooking a car onto your fishing pole and trying to bring it in.
The sharks in these waters aren't endangered, but to help ocean conservation, the group plans to tag and release every fish they catch.
Fish on, buddy!
What would you need?
Yeah, get it.
Harnessed into his fighting gear, Jimmy soon gets a powerful bite.
Hey, okay.
The corner.
But there's something wrong.
When the fish runs, the reel's supposed to give line out so it doesn't snap the line. But it wasn't. It was binding up and the pole was bending in half. And then it would give out line fast, so I knew there was something wrong with the reel. But I figured if there's a problem, the line's gonna snap.
With his friends encouraging him, Jimmy refuses to quit.
Right out there, I see color.
Yep. The fish approaches the boat. It's a mammoth blue shark.
Look at the size of it. Wow.
Blue sharks are known as tenacious fighters that can grow up to 3 meters, weighing nearly a quarter of a ton.
Look at the size of that shark. Wow.
It's gonna take off, hold on.
Suddenly, the huge predator dives to the bottom. Disaster. Jimmy's friends have no time to stop him as he hits the water.
You're in a state of shock. I just went, he's over. You know, and everybody went to the back of the boat, and you're looking to see where you could see him, and you couldn't see him.
Worse still, Jimmy's still attached to his fishing rod.
I felt my feet leaving the deck of the boat. I thought, this is it, I'm dead. I actually had no hope. I couldn't see where I could release myself.
With each second, the huge shark pulls Jimmy deeper.
I thought that it was the end. And then I felt it give line out.
Jimmy!
The angler struggles desperately to undo his harness.
And I'm like, oh my God, I got another chance. So I swam back to the top. I swam to the surface, and I'm the happiest I've ever been because I made it. And now I realize that I'm in the middle of feeding sharks.
Jimmy's friends take hold, pulling as hard as they can.
River's on and over.
Everybody's holding on to each other, and I can hear Jimmy say, don't let me go.
The men work their way to the hatch on the rear of the boat. With a final pull, the crew yanks Jimmy onto the deck.
Jimmy,
God,
I was laying on the floor for a couple of minutes, and I'm like, I can't believe I'm still on the boat. I didn't think I'd ever see this boat again. At this point, now I'm starting to get angry. I'm like, I can't believe this fish pulled me overboard.
I'm trying to unhook the reel.
And I said, give me that pole back. I'm bringing them in.
Incredibly, the fish is still hooked to Jimmy's harness. Gathering his remaining strength, fighting as hard as the exhausted angler can. Jimmy D'Ambra reels in the massive blue shark that almost pulled him to his death.
Whoa. Well, this is something I think you're never gonna forget.
Oh. After the ordeal, the group decides to forego tagging in order to release the tired predator as quickly as possible.
I wasn't angry at the fish because, I mean, he's trying to get away. He wasn't trying to kill me. And the beautiful fish. I mean, you see them swimming around the boat. You don't want to harm them in any way. He pulled me over, and he threw me back, so now we're even. I caught him loose, and now he's gone.
Let's go! All right!
An ocean away for the Marlin Spear Tagging Expedition. It's day 2 of 4. February the 12th, 2010, Pukenoi, New Zealand.
Enough guns for two guys.
They're ready to tackle their coveted spear tagging target, the striped marlin. The team heads northwards towards New Zealand's ultimate fishing grounds. 115 kilometers from Pukenoi, off the northernmost tip of New Zealand, the Three Kings Islands inhabit a remote corner of the Pacific. These rocky outposts are known for their dangerous currents, unpredictable weather, and a host of predators at the top of the food chain.
There's lots and lots of sharks, lots of bronze whalers, lots of marlin, macos, great whites.
One of the greatest risks, of course, just getting lost at sea. You know, I mean, I know we've got a boat there, but we're a long way offshore. There's some huge currents there that will be moving us very quickly.
It's a five-hour journey to the Three Kings. But no amount of preparation can safeguard against every risk.
I definitely wouldn't get in the water with these things, you know. Or other predatory fish that you wouldn't want to come across when they're hungry. Yeah, it's all pretty crazy if you ask me.
With spawning striped marlin on the decline, the team is determined to try to make marlin conservation history. Yet to do it, everything must go off without a hitch. Striped marlin are able to reach nearly 4 meters long, weighing up to 200 kilograms. These muscular billfish sport prominent pectoral fins and jutting bills twice as long as their jaws. Pointed swords strike into schools of prey, from sardines to squid. Marlin use their bills like clubs, causing blunt trauma, disabling victims in seconds. But it's the marlin's stripes that make a close encounter unforgettable. With up to 20 vertical stripes from tip to tail, striped marlin light up when they're excited or hunting. Nerve-triggered skin cells, called chromatophores, respond to stimuli with a phosphorescent glow, distracting prey while the marlin charge in for the kill. For the expedition team, spear tagging one of the fastest fighting fish in the ocean presents two major challenges. First, luring a free-swimming and skittish marlin to the back of the boat without using rod and reel. Second, keeping the marlin there long enough to shoot a satellite tack, securing it at the right spot. To do it, the team has a carefully sequenced plan. They'll trail lures behind the boat, enticing the predator to come in close.
Marlin comes up, very much tunnel vision. It's focusing on that food, so that gives us a window of opportunity to come on or slip off the back of the boat and position ourselves so I can get a nice shot off above the dorsal.
Once a marlin appears, the crew wants to keep the predator hanging around.
That's a perfect live bait size, that one.
To prepare the bait, they tie live skipjack tuna to lines. Steve plans to jump in the water holding the line-tied bait directly into the charging predator's path.
Sharks and other species are used to following lures. Well, Steve's the lure in this situation, so we'll just keep an eye on him.
For the plan to work, the team's timing must be perfect. But first, they have to wait for their target.
It can drive you crazy waiting for days on end on the back of the boat in the beating sun. There's no wind at all, so that's not going to cool you down. And you're sitting in a wetsuit most of the time as well, so you're sweating inside there. It's just really hard to stay focused.
Expedition biologist Gillian Morris prepares the tag for deployment.
The moment of truth is nearing. This is what we've come for. This is what it all comes down to. So it's game time.
It's a marlin. The crew scrambles to get the lines in and lure the fish in close.
All yours!
Woohoo! Yes, man!
The divers struggle to get their bearings, scanning the water for the hunting marlin's exact position. Drawn to Steve's bait, the marlin moves in aggressively.
Now they just come right at you. They're so focused. They drop their picks and they hunch their shoulders. So very threatening and exhilarating to see.
If the marlin senses a threat, it could flee at any moment.
Just there.
Got it.
Steve and Dean have just seconds to work their plan and take the shot.
Only a couple meters away.
This is bloody awesome, man.
He waits for Dean to align himself and take the shot.
I look to my left and there it is. This huge big marlin just right next to me swimming around. And it was hanging around, it was incredible.
Where's that fish going? Where is it?
Hey,
where?
It's just here.
Chasing the bait, the marlin circles Steve. But Dean is nowhere to be found.
There he is!
Strong currents have taken the diver out of range.
Yeah, we're coming!
The marlin swims off. The team's tagging opportunity is lost.
He's just swimming around me, real close. He wanted a live bait. I don't think that thing was lively enough. It was just swimming upside down, just kicking. It would have been really fortunate if Dean was there at that time, because it was close enough to spear. It was just one of those moments that you dream of, that it would come that close.
Boy, they're beautiful. They are stunning. I'm so disappointed. I just couldn't quite get in there in time. But it would have been beautiful to be down there beside it and have a go with the tagging system.
Does Dusk approaches as the expedition heads back to the relative shelter of the islands. Tomorrow, their mission will continue. The hunt for a striped marlin and a spear-tagging victory. Expedition day 3 of 4. The team heads out for the next marlin tagging attempt. After hours at sea, their patience is tested again.
Yeah, I'm just gonna sit here and meditate on the back of the boat.
It's mid-afternoon, and the crew is having trouble getting a marlin in close enough to take a shot. Concerned with the spear tagging's odds of success, the team wants to ensure the expedition isn't wasted. They'll try to tag at least one marlin the old-fashioned way, using a rod and reel. But no matter what the tagging method, across an ocean, one unforgettable collision between man and billfish proves that tagging can be dangerous for both the fish and the fishermen. Hundreds of kilometers across the Tasman Sea. October the 28th, 2008, North Queensland, Australia. Fisherman Simon Osterberry and his wife Margot are celebrating their 10th wedding anniversary, chasing and tagging the elusive black marlin.
They're the ultimate apex predator. They're massive. If you see big black marlin come out of the water, that head coming out of the water is nothing like it.
The couple is competing in one of the most prestigious tournaments in the world, the Lizard Island Black Marlin Classic. The goal is to tag the most marlin over a 7-day period, implanting serial numbered fisheries tags. The simple tags record catch location and size. Future anglers who later catch and release the same marlin can report any changes in the animal's vital statistics.
Yeah, perfect.
Halfway through the trip, the Osterberry's team has caught and released 6 fish and missed a few along the way.
Nah, I reckon I've dropped him. He's still here. We'll get him.
Now, with 2 days left, they're in second place.
We needed probably 2 fish. We needed a fish to catch the leader, and we needed a fish to go past the leader. And then that would have put us in the box seat. And there's pressure, there is pressure there.
There's a fish!
On the left!
On the left! On the left!
As line rips out in a blur, Simon grabs the rod, locking himself into the fighting chair.
Right down.
I'm on one.
Job done. And that fish was going ballistic, just kept jumping and jumping. It was pretty good.
I'm coming up again, coming up. Get the tag forward.
Without warning, the marlin charges. It's heading towards the back of the boat.
I literally just went head down, crank, crank, crank. And I could feel loose line. I thought I'd lost it. I thought I'd lost the fish.
Nobody pick up.
Unaware, the fish is barely a meter from the stern. Simon reels as hard as he can.
And just as I looked up, Jeff was standing literally right in front of me. And as I looked up, he moved, and all I could see was a marlin head about there.
Crewmate Jeff Hudson dives out of the way just as the fish launches past his head.
Again, I just remember turning around expecting the worst, to see blood everywhere. You know, I thought for sure it would have impaled Simon.
Instead, the fish has torn through the side of Simon's shirt, missing him by mere centimeters.
Get the door open! Get the door open!
And now, the fighting marlin is in the boat.
When it got on the deck, it just did not stop. It was just bang, 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 bang. And it wanted to get back in the water.
The team makes a daring decision.
everybody kind of froze for a second, and then, you know, reality, you know, came back, and we were like, wow, we're in a tournament. You can tag this fish. It still counts.
It's going crazy on the underneath me. Try and make sure that I don't get speared by the fish. And Jeff comes in, grabs a tail, and Pete's grabbed a bill.
Cut it off, cut it off!
And landed backing the fish out.
Careful, careful, careful.
The crew tags the black marlin and releases it back into the ocean.
Probably about 15 minutes later, when we all had sort of time for it to sink in, how serious the situation was, how close it was, and how lucky we were that actually nobody got injured because there were so many people on deck. Simon was right in the firing line, he was right in the chair, so you've got nowhere to go.
Unlucky, and could have speared me right through the chest. And if that had happened, I'd be dead. I guarantee I'd be dead.
Well done, buddy.
The team didn't win the Lizard Island Classic that year, but their footage captured one of the most extraordinary and unforgettable close encounters in the tournament's history.
Yeah, I think we'll call it even. Call it a draw. I survived, he survived.
I have never seen a marlin do that.
February the 14th, 2010, back off the coast of New Zealand's Three Kings Islands.
When I cranked this one in, there was a fish around under the boat. You see me cranking that one in and he's popped up.
It's the final day of the four-day marlin spear tagging mission. After repeated attempts, the expedition is still hoping to draw a striped marlin close enough to be within tagging range.
So it's really important we keep a close eye on these things. It can be the difference between success and failure, for sure.
The crew trails hookless lures to draw a marlin to the back of the boat.
Is it happening there, man?
Steve then plans to leap in the water holding a live tuna attached to a rope. With the marlin busy chasing Steve's bait, Dean will have just seconds to implant the tag.
Please be good to me.
You're on the short there. On the short there.
Mark's just spotted a striped marlin behind the right rigger.
One net teaser, Steve. One net teaser.
An enormous marlin charges after one of the hookless lures. The divers get ready.
There's one right underneath us.
Now chasing Steve's bait, the marlin weaves through the two divers.
It's just like a little rabbit running in a field. They just run any direction they wanted. Like these marlin, they just change direction. They're coming in and out on you. They're turning around really fast.
Steve clings to the live bait. If the marlin actually catches the tuna, it will devour it immediately and swim away. Dean has only seconds to take the shot. But in the churning sea, he can no longer see the marlin or his partner.
Hey, look at the life bait here, Dean.
Still holding the tuna, Steve's waiting for Dean to take a shot.
I knew if Dean had the opportunity, he would nail it. There's no question in my mind.
The marlin is over 7.5 meters away, twice as far as the known range of Dean's spear gun.
And at that point, I just didn't know. I had this horrible feeling that this would be our only chance.
Worse yet, the striped marlin appears to be changing course, heading away from the divers. Dean makes a split-second decision.
Just stretched out, aimed at the fish, and just bang! There's this percussion sound in the water, and the fish just took off like an absolute bullet.
Dean's tag landed. He looks on as the tagged marlin launches into the distance.
Wow, man, look at him go! Fantastic!
As I hit the surface, I saw it smashing across the top of the wave. I spun around to the camera and he goes, "Nice one, mate, good shot." Of course, the crew, when I popped out ahead of the crew, they had no idea what was going on.
When I got back on the boat, I'm thinking that's just another opportunity gone. My goodness, you're going to be waiting hours for another marlin.
At one point, the marlin was just flying. Yeah, pretty intense.
There he is.
The guy! I think I got it! I got it!
He tagged it! Woo!
I was so buzzed. When I actually knew we'd got it, and it was positioned okay, fantastic.
That gun's just come on board. That $4,500 tag's just disappeared. Marlin swimming off towards the horizon, look very, very healthy. Amazing, man.
I'm about to
take it off.
But the real test is, will the tag stay in long enough to gather critical data? Heading back to shore, the expedition team is hopeful. But they have to wait for their satellite tag's final results.
Good job, guys.
Awesome, mate.
Good job, good job. Thank you. Great job.
A month later, the verdict is in. The MK10 PAT satellite tag reports its data back to expedition team leader Dr. Tim Sipple.
It was fantastic. We got the tag in and we got the information back that we've been wanting for several years now, and it's really exciting to see the behavior of the animal showing us the patterns that we were expecting to see.
For Tim, it's a conservation breakthrough. Unlike marlin he's tagged by rod and reel, this time the spear-tagged marlin stayed in its normal feeding grounds. This will help scientists better understand how to compare and contrast data collected through different tagging methods. The Three Kings Islands mission was a success.
It really did help to have two of the world's best spear fishermen on the job. Getting that tag in, that was probably the X factor that made this all work.
It's all about understanding and protecting some of the ocean's most treasured game fish. When science and sport combine to forge new frontiers in conservation technology, future generations of man and beast may have more extraordinary close encounters.